never fails, will not fail me now, will not fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out, working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh yes, I
may be seated. We're going to go into a time of communion now. So we've been doing this for a few weeks now, but just the communion is to the sides of your rows, and just take it whenever you're ready. now David for the message.
All right. Let's give it up really nice for the worship. That's right. How you guys doing tonight? Good. Look how talented I am, guys. Of course, I don't need help. I'm obviously doing this very well. Bam. All right, let's give a clap to that, yeah? I'm just kidding. You don't have to clap. That's silly. Stop it. It's not clap worthy. All right, how you guys doing? I'm good. Thanks for asking. I'm good. I'm great. Where's Cameron? Cameron, stand up. Everybody say hi, Cameron. Cameron, say hi, everybody. I just wanted to do that because he made like every other leader do that like 15 minutes ago. So, little, how's that medicine taste? Your own flavored? All right. Pastor Amy's not here, so we're just doing whatever we want today, huh? All right. Pastor Amy's at a conference. She's getting equipped for you guys because she loves you guys so much. All right. What's funny about that? Oh, you guys are just laughing. You guys are just having your own conversation, laughing, not listening to me whatsoever. And I thought it was about what I said, but it's your own thing. That's cool. But also listen. Also pay attention. All right. Okay. So we're talking about Habakkuk. Who was here last week? Who was here last Wednesday? Awesome. Great job. Great job coming to church. Who has their Bible with them? Who has their Bible with them? Physical Bible, one of these things. All right. I think we'll start giving out prizes for people who bring their physical Bible. What do you guys think? Should we do that? You're already doing that for everybody? Mr. Paul has a chocolate for anybody who has brought their Bible today. Shelby has $25 for everybody who brought their Bible. Oh, so we're not then, huh? Okay. So last week, Pastor Michelle talked about the first chapter of Habakkuk. She pronounced it Habakkuk, but I'm pronouncing it Habakkuk. It's okay. Different people. It's all right. We were just raised different. That's all. So it's a joke. Remember, I say jokes up here sometimes. It's okay to laugh. Even if they're not funny, it's okay to laugh. That's right. But only when I make a joke. Okay. Thank you. That sounded like nervous laughter. Habakkuk's a fun book, right? If you guys remember, in the first chapter of Habakkuk, he's like, God, this world sucks, and you're not doing anything about it, and what you are doing is not enough, and I could probably do this better. And God's like, okay, I got you. I'm going to send the Babylonians to enslave Israel. How does that sound? And Habakkuk's like, that's not fair. And God's like, deal with it. So that's a fun book, right? Just to recap, the Israelites deserved. So the Babylonians came and conquered Israel. It's something that God did because he promised if the Israelites did not obey him like he asked them to and like they promised to, he was going they were going to have consequences for that. And he gave them like a billion chances over a couple hundred years and they still didn't keep their part of the deal. So now this is their consequence that they knew, they understood was the deal. And that's what's going on. And that's what God is telling Habakkuk about. So we've been wrestling with questions for God, right? With if we have questions or doubts about God and what he's doing, what we see he's doing, what we don't see he's doing. And today, what I want to talk about is when we're there, because a reality of our faith walk is we're all going to get there at some point, probably multiple times in our walk. We're going to get to a point where we're like, this doesn't add up. This isn't fair. This isn't okay. I don't like this. But the key is not staying there. The key is giving God a chance to respond to our questions, to respond to our doubt. So even if we're in a time like in Habakkuk 1, where there's a problem, there's a complaint going on. And God's not afraid of that, by the way. God's not afraid of our complaining. He's not afraid of our doubts. He's not afraid of our questions. He can handle them. What do we do? How do we respond? What do we do in our lives when we pray and nothing happens? Or even more, what do we do in our lives when we pray and not only does it not get better, but things get worse? What's our response? Do we say, forget you, God, and we just stop asking questions altogether? Do we stop listening for an answer altogether just because it didn't come when we wanted it to come? When we thought it should come? What do we do? How do we embrace God and believe when believing gets hard? That's what question I want to talk about today. And if we remember from last week, Pastor Michelle said Habakkuk's name, his name means to embrace. To embrace. So that's what we're learning to do. That's the journey that Habakkuk is on. How do I embrace God through all this that I don't like what I see? I don't like what's happening, God. I don't like what you're doing. But how do I embrace you? How do I shift my perspective? The first three verses of chapter 2 give us a little roadmap of what we can do. So how do we embrace God through these difficulty and the questions? Number one, we stop and listen. Stop and listen. Habakkuk 2:1 says this, I will stand at my watch and station myself on the ramparts. I will look to see what he will say to me and what answer I am to give to this complaint. So Habakkuk gets done complaining in chapter 1. God says, this is my response. And he doesn't like it. He doesn't think it's fair. He doesn't get it. So what does he do? What's his response? He's going to stop and listen. It says, I will look to see what he will say to me. Now I want to acknowledge something here. Now this is the key. This is the first step to moving past the questions and the doubt and into what's next. But this isn't easy. It takes intentionality. It takes intentionality to give God the chance to respond. But the first step in a journey is the most important one. It's what gets us going. And we got to do it on purpose. This can look a lot of ways, stopping and listening. It could be different from person to person. It could be different from in this moment God spoke to me this way and in this moment God spoke to me that way. But I do promise that when we ask questions, God's faithful. He loves us. He speaks to us when we're listening. Sometimes we got to learn how to listen. Sometimes he speaks to us through his word, which is why it's so important to read the Bible, get to know it, get to know God, get to know what he sounds like, the kinds of things that he says. Sometimes he speaks through us through circumstances, you know. Sometimes we're like, God, can you give me a sign? And he's faithful. He does sometimes. Not always. But sometimes he does. Sometimes he speaks through us, through other people. But one thing that is for sure is that no matter what way he talks to you, it takes focusing on him in order to hear, in order to listen. You got to focus on God, and he's faithful to communicate most of the time. But sometimes he doesn't say anything. But that doesn't mean he's not communicating with you, okay? Him, if you don't hear him in a moment, in a time, he's still trying to tell you something. Now, I'm not here to tell you what that is. I'm not suggesting it's because, like, you're not good enough for God to talk to you. That's not how God works, okay? He loves you. You ask him into your life. He loves you. He talks to you. But sometimes he's communicating something with silence. How many of y'all know that we can communicate a whole lot by not saying anything, right? Oh, yeah. So, what else? Sometimes his answer is just no. That sucks. Sometimes God answers prayer, but sometimes his answer is just no. So what do we do? What do we do when we ask God a question and we don't like what he says, or we don't hear, or the answer is just no. One thing we can do is we can change our perspective about it, because we can understand that God knows better than we do, okay? And this is a hard process to understand, that somebody knows better, because we see the situation from our perspective and we think, oh, I know just how to fix this. I know just what to do. But God knows things. He has a perspective from way up here. He sees things that we don't. He knows things that we don't know. So we got to have his perspective. So it's as simple as this, right? This hits different when gas is like $10 a gallon, right? For those of you who drive, right? But look at, see, like on the one hand, you're like, I'm in trouble. But then you just change your perspective and you're like, nah, I'm all right. So sometimes we don't like the answer, you know, just kind of change the perspective. You think, you know what, we're all right. We're all right. We can make it a few more miles. All right. We got to stop and listen. God's faithful. He will respond to you in some way. I'm not saying that because, like, you can't. Don't take it to the bank because David says it. Take it to the bank because God says it. Okay? So what's next? What else can we do? We stop and listen. What's the next step? Write down what you hear. Number two. Write down what you hear. Write it down somewhere. I know what you're thinking. Nobody writes anything down anymore. Well, then say, Alexa, make a note. God said this, right? And then, you know, it's like, God said, you know, whatever, right? Habakkuk 2:2. Then the Lord replied. This is after verse 1 where Habakkuk is waiting to hear what God's going to say. Habakkuk 2:2 says this. Then the Lord replied, write down the revelation and make it plain on tablets so that the herald may run with it. Why does it matter to write it down? Why does it matter to, like, write it down somewhere? Whether it's a note in your phone, write it on a piece of paper, write it on a postcard, put it up on your mirror. I mean, first of all, when God talks to us, that's a significant thing. It's for our benefit. And the way our mind works is it transfers it from being an idea that's easily forgotten into something tangible, something you can see and feel. This is important. Because the circumstance doesn't always change just because God speaks about it. The problem isn't always fixed just because God answered your prayer. Because he may not answer by fixing the problem. He may answer by just informing you about something. He gives you something that gives you peace. He speaks something to you that gives you hope. But it doesn't always change the circumstance. And when we write something down, we can go back to it. We can go back to the truth. Like, I know this is what I'm seeing. I know this is what I'm hearing. But here's what God told me. Here's the truth of what God spoke to me. And that keeps us hanging on. So basically what I'm saying is writing something down is like having the high ground. Right? Like against Anakin. I don't know what you're thinking. I'm super smart. You underestimate me. I don't have to write it down. Well, it didn't work out well for that guy, did it? No, it did not. He lost all of his arms and legs. Now, don't go home and say, no, David at church told me that if I don't write my prayers down, that all my legs and arms are going to fall off. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying, write down what God tells you because it's important. That's it. All right, here's number three. You guys ready? Point number three. First, we stop and listen. Second, we write it down. And here's the last step. Wait. Man, that was hard. Just waiting for me to say something again, wasn't it? We hate waiting, don't we? You're like, what is he doing up there? Did he fall asleep? Is this man having a stroke on stage right now? No, it's funny. Come on, that's a joke. I'm not having a stroke. We hate waiting, don't we? We hate it. Oh, I know. I know you guys hate waiting. Habakkuk 2:3. The revelation awaits an appointed time. It speaks to the end and will not prove false. Though it linger, wait for it. It'll certainly come and not delay. So this revelation, what God told Habakkuk about the Babylonians coming, he's saying that's going to happen. It might take a while, but that's not because it's not on time. It's because it's waiting for the right time. You just have to wait to see it. It will not prove false. What God speaks to you, you can bank on it. It just might not happen how you think and when you think. We love to wait, which means we hate to wait. But God does some real powerful work in the waiting. In fact, a lot of the Bible is all about waiting. Much of the Old Testament is all about the world waiting for a Savior, Jesus Christ. And then after the story of Jesus, the Bible after that is us waiting for him to come again. Even individual Bible stories, a lot of them about waiting. God promised Eve, you know, the first woman, that her offspring would defeat the serpent, the enemy, that showed up in the garden. That offspring was Jesus. Thousands of years from the promise to when it came true. Moses wandered in the desert for 40 years with the Israelites, and they had to wait to go into the promised land. Moses didn't even get to go in. Waiting. David was anointed king as a teenager and had to wait several years being chased around, wanted to be killed before he actually sat on the throne. And another promise to David was that his offspring would be king forever, and that's Jesus. Now, the prophecy came through that somebody from the lineage of David, Jesus, would be Messiah, but we're still waiting for him to come run this whole thing, right? Right. The disciples, after Jesus' death, they had to wait 3 days until the resurrection. But there's power in each and every one of those waiting periods. From when David was anointed to when he became king, those years forged him into the king he was. When the disciples were running scared, waiting for the resurrection to happen, which they had their doubts, it forged them into the passionate apostles they were, taking the gospel to the world after the resurrection. There's power in the waiting. Isaiah 40:31 says this. Isaiah 40:31. But those who wait on the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. So here's what I want you to notice. Waiting is not an idle thing. It is not an idle waiting, which means it doesn't mean you're doing nothing just because we're waiting. Just because we're waiting for God to fulfill, for us to see what God spoke to us, for us to see what God is yet to fulfill. That doesn't mean we're doing nothing. We could be soaring, flying high, feeling great, right? Soar on wings like eagles. Run and not grow weary. We could be running, working hard. We could be walking, just getting by, one step in front of the other. And that's all we can muster. But that's okay. That doesn't mean we're standing still. That doesn't mean we're doing nothing. And here's what this waiting period allows to happen. When our circumstance doesn't change, when our questions don't go answered, when we still have those questions, when we wait on God and hold on to what he spoke to us, even when it doesn't change what's happening, it allows God to change us. It allows God to change our perspective. I've personally been in this process myself for the last year. Okay, so I'm not going into too many details about it, but you know, I want to be vulnerable with you guys because like this, I want to show you how this Old Testament book written thousands of years ago applies to my life, our life today. Okay? Because I know it's hard to make those connections sometimes. But let me tell you a little bit about myself. Okay? A little bit over a year ago, I was unexpectedly let go from my last job after 8 years of working there. 8 years of working, and I volunteered for 5 or 6 years before that, so about 13 total years of my life I gave to this organization. And they unexpectedly let me go. And it was a very big deal, obviously, to me. Kind of threw my life upside down. And I was like, why, God? This doesn't make sense. This isn't fair. This isn't okay. I got 3 kids. I got a wife. And now I have no job, which means I'm making no money. But my kids still need to eat. I don't understand. So first, I go home the day it happened, and I pray with my wife. Yeah, I'm reeling. I don't get it. I have questions. I can't understand why. And I had built relationship. This was a ministry that I built relationship with a lot of people, and now that's just gone. Okay? It ripped my heart in half. But I stopped, and I prayed. Only by his grace. Not because I'm like this super great spiritual guy. It's just purely by the grace of God. I stopped and I listened. I said, God, what are you doing? I prayed with some family. I prayed with some friends, telling them what's happening. And they got all kinds of opinions on what they think I should do. And in my head, I'm like, I got to do something. I have to get a job. I have to make money, right? I have to feed my family. So I just start going, what do I need to do? What do I need to do? And God said, this is what God spoke to me in that time. I said, what do I got to do, God? I got to start making money as fast as possible. What do I got to do? And he said, be still and know that I'm God. Which is a scripture in the Bible. He said, be still and know that I'm God. And I said, okay, God, I get that. Yes, you're in control. But, you know, I got to do something. I got to do in my power what I can do. He said, no, be still and know that I'm God. Well, I didn't listen very well because I started applying to a bunch of jobs. And over a few months, I applied to like 50 jobs. And I didn't hear back from a single one. From a single one, okay? Now, this isn't normal to apply to that many. And like, they didn't tell me no. I just heard nothing, okay? Now, this is just my experience, okay? But normally, they at least tell you no if they're not going to hire you. Sometimes, you know, people just ignore you. But 50 jobs ignored me? There's something else going on here. So I say, okay, God, I'm not making money. And all along the way, God is providing for my family. Supernatural, if you want to hear some really awesome God stories, come talk to me later. Because God, seriously, miracles supernaturally has provided for my family for the last year, okay? So I'm praying. I say, okay, God, this isn't working out. What do I got to do? And he said, this is what God spoke to me the second time where the first time I didn't listen, say, be still and know that I'm God. This is what he said. I am in the waiting. I'm in the waiting. I said, okay, God, I wait. I just wait. I just sit here. I do nothing. He said, no, you don't stay still. You don't do nothing, but you wait for what I'm going to do. And this is the season I've been in for the last several months. Now, obviously, I'm not doing nothing because I'm up here. You've seen me up here over the last several months. I'm doing something. But I don't know where God's leading all this. And I'm in school full time right now, too. I started school before any of this went down. So he said, be faithful to what I told you. And he gave me peace about waiting. So I haven't realized where he's taken me, but I'm still waiting. But I'm not just doing nothing. Because our faith is not a blind faith. We know God, or at least we can, if we take the time to get to know him. We know God. We know his will. We know his love. He proved it through Jesus Christ. God proved his love through Jesus Christ. Habakkuk didn't have the benefit of these 66 books, did he? The words and the acts of God. He was still expected to believe and trust. How much more with the resources that we have, with a God who still talks to us, should we? Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for your word. I thank you for your sacrifice. And Lord, we know that this world can be pretty messed up sometimes, that none of our lives are perfect. But we also know through it all, you're faithful, you're with us, you're good. And Lord, if some of us have problems believing those things, would you meet us in those questions? Would you meet us in those doubts? As we head into small group time, Holy Spirit, would you be with us? Would you direct the conversation? Would you speak to our hearts, to our souls, Lord, to our spirits? Would you speak to us so that we may have a stronger, real faith with you? Amen. Okay, so just to let you guys know, Erica's group, eighth grade girls, you're going to be with Sarah today. And then Cameron and Chris's group, y'all are by the fire pit. All right? Have a good small group.